Hello everybody and welcome to this video. It's the continuation in the series analysing William Shakespeare's Much Ado About Nothing. Everything you see in this video series comes from the ebook. Now, the ebook contains the complete original Shakespearean text, a line-by-line translation of the whole thing into modern English, and detailed analysis of every scene. It was written by Edna Hobbs, who's one of the MrBruff.com team, and is available for just £3.99 at MrBruff.com or Amazon.co.uk if you have a Kindle. So all I'm doing in the video series is I'm going through the analysis of the scenes, but for the translation into modern English, you need to pick up the ebook. And there's lots more stuff in the ebook as well, so do get a copy. Okay, so Act 2, Scene 1. To make sense of this scene, it's best to think of a series of snapshots showing what's happening to lots of different people. Now, first off, let's summarise this scene. So, it opens with some gossip from mocking Don John's sullen behaviour. The conversation moves to Benedick and so to husbands and Beatrice's determination not to marry. Leonardo and Antonio remind Hero to remember to do what they told her to do with regard to Don Pedro, but Beatrice warns her about marriage and tells her to make sure she pleases herself too. When the guests enter, Don Pedro singles Hero out immediately, and because she's been warned to expect wooing, Hero's responses are quite flirtatious. Various dancers meet and guess who is behind the mask, and they also say things they might not normally say to each other. Baraccio chats at Margaret, Antonio and Ursula flirt, Beatrice uses the opportunity to mock Benedick. Don John uses the anonymity of the mask to pretend that he thinks Claudio is Benedick and warns him that Don Pedro is actually going to marry Hero himself. Claudio immediately believes that his friend has double-crossed him and is of course bitter. Now Benedick, who didn't hear Don Pedro promise to woo Hero on Claudio's behalf, probably also believes that Don Pedro loves Hero, but he finds it amusing and expects Claudio to be able to laugh it off when he teases him. Claudio is upset and leaves, and Benedick thinks about what Beatrice said about him and vows revenge. When Don Pedro arrives, he tells him that Claudio is upset, so Don Pedro explains the true situation, and the audience hears that Claudio and Hero are going to get married. And then he tells Benedick that Beatrice has told him that one of her dance partners, who they both know is Benedick, told her that Benedick has been slandering her. And this winds Benedick up and he blurts out how hurt he's been by the insults and he wants to go away on any sort of mission that he can be sent on. Don Pedro tells Beatrice she's gone too far and lost Benedick's heart, and she confesses that they were once close but both cheated on each other, hence the mistrust and war between them. Neither wants the other to get the upper hand. She tries to turn it into a joke by suggesting that if she let Benedick get on top of her, she'd have babies as stupid as he is. And Beatrice then says that she's brought Claudio as asked and hints at why he is so miserable, which gives Don Pedro the opportunity of breaking the good news to him and telling Claudio that everything is arranged, he just needs to name the wedding day. He doesn't say a word in all of this. Beatrice then moans about the fact that everybody's getting married except her, and then we have that very awkward moment where Don Pedro offers to marry her, and she says he's too good for her. And as soon as she leaves on an errand, Leonardo reminds her of Don Pedro says that she would make an excellent wife for Benedick. He asks the others to help him bring Beatrice and Benedick together, and they agree to do so. So a huge scene where lots happens, but what we're going to look at in terms of analysis is the genre and the form, the themes and the characters. So, as we've talked about before, this is a comedy in genre, and one of the characteristics of comedy is that tricks can be played when people are wearing masks. We call this a convention, a generic convention, something that we regularly see, an arrangement that we often see in the genre. Because we all agree as part of the game of comedy that to believe in the power of masks to disguise is actually effective. So if you watch the film, you think, you know, well, you can tell who it is beneath that mask. But the sort of We're sort of, it's like we're sort of drawn into believing something that isn't quite real because we know it's a light-hearted comedy storyline. So when Ursula shows that she's talking to Antonio, it's quite easy to recognize people from their mannerisms and voice. But because of this, people are able to say things to each other that they couldn't normally say. So we notice that Benedict can't defend himself against Beatrice's attack without giving away the fact that he is Benedict, whom he pretends not to know, which he can't do because he's already slandered her as if he didn't know he was talking to her. Don John, recognizing Claudio, uses the mask to his own advantage. He pretends he thinks Claudio's Benedict and so suggests he could be a good friend to Claudio by letting him know that Don Pedro's double-crossed him and is actually going to marry Hero himself that very night. It's important to remember the form. The text you're reading in class is a play. This is a script, but it needs actors to bring it to life, and they do that in many different ways, that every production of the play has its own insights and interpretations. In one interpretation, Benedict speaks in a funny voice to ensure he isn't recognized. In another, Beatrice and Benedict are middle-aged, suggesting that their on-off affair has been going on for years. The actors can suggest a more intimate relationship exists between Borachio and Margaret, for example, based on claims that he makes later in the play. So Benedict's response to Claudio's sulks about Don Pedro stealing Hero could be played in two ways. If we assume he knows nothing of the plan to woo Hero on Claudio's behalf, he might think the prince, Don Pedro, has beaten Claudio to it, and that means that we just think it's a fair duel. On the other hand, it's likely he's heard the plan, sees Claudio moping around, and can't believe he really thinks Don Pedro would cheat on him. So he's sarcastic when he suggests ways in which to wear the willow. Similarly, some productions suggest Don Pedro might be a little in love with Beatrice when he asks her to marry him. Others show it as a way of testing her. Is she hinting or regretting her determination never to marry? One of the reasons Shakespeare's remained fresh and interesting for over 400 years is because there's plenty of scope for interpretation. When you write about the text, remember you can also mention alternative interpretations. So if you can, watch lots of different productions of the play, or at least clips of them. Don't let the albeit very good film version with Denzel Washington make you think that's the only way we can interpret this play. Now on to structure. This scene is made up of lots of mini scenes, snapshots of what's happening at the party, little episodes. So we call the structure of this scene episodic. Each change of focus is like a puzzle piece of the bigger picture, which builds on information that we as the audience remember from Act One and prepares for the action of the rest of the play. The scene begins with Beatrice scorning marriage in as much detail as Benedict's done in Act One, immediately emphasizing the connection between them, that each is energetically, of course, denying. They say they hate each other, but as an audience, we look at it and we can see more of the ongoing merry war between Beatrice and Benedict. Hero is wooed and won for Claudio. Don John begins the mischief he began to plot in Act One by suggesting he's been betrayed. And slipped in there so that it doesn't stand out too much is a seed sown that will bear fruit later in the play, Borachio's relationship with Margaret. Of course, that's going to be very important. The cliffhanger of the scene is Don Pedro's announcement that he plans to get Beatrice and Benedict to marry each other. Let's finish off with the themes then. Of course, marriage is a theme. When Beatrice turns down Don Pedro, it's clear to him that she must be in love with Benedict because he would be as good a catch for her as anybody. She seems not to have parents, though she's financially secure enough not to be treated like a servant in her uncle's home. And make a note of this, she's not Antonio's daughter, though he is Hero's uncle and Leonardo is her uncle. She calls him too costly because she knows he's of a higher social status, and also that she would not be able to play the role of princess. She's too opinionated. While men have more freedom, despite Benedict's description of marriage being to thrust thy neck into a yoke, women are expected to be obedient to fathers and husbands, as Hero has already been ordered to by her father and her uncle at the start of the scene. So Beatrice tells her to please herself, an attitude which is unsuited to the role of Don Pedro's wife. The idea of being yoked is this idea you can see in the picture of farming where the cattle are yoked together, the ox. So marriage as a yoke means, you know, we're stuck together, there's no escape. Appearance versus reality yet again shows its face as an important theme. The masks emphasize that things aren't necessarily as they appear. They allow deceptions like Don John's lie to Claudio and the slanders Beatrice and Benedick report to hurt each other. Don Pedro looks as if he's chatting Hero up, but in reality it's sticking to his deal with Claudio and winning her on his behalf. Don John appears to be giving Claudio helpful advice via his friend Benedick, but in reality is trying to hurt Claudio and bring his brother into disrepute. And the characters then, well, Beatrice and Benedick, we see how similar they are, beginning with Beatrice's tirade against marriage, which is so similar to Benedick's that we saw in Act 1, Scene 1. And just as Benedick unwittingly revealed that he thinks Beatrice is more beautiful than Hero, Beatrice, talking about Don John, suggests that a mix between him and Benedick would make the ideal husband. The fact that they can both still hurt each other proves that they care about what the other one thinks of them, and with their past relationship revealed, and the evidence that Beatrice is not looking to marry anyone else, not even a catch like Don Pedro, the way is clear to plot their union. After all, Don Pedro wants to see Benedick look pale with love. Please do subscribe to the channel and pick up the ebook.